This is a community-supported legal education channel. Find out how you can support our mission at the links in the description below.
Out of the appeals court in Georgia, we have a case called Maynard et al. Versus Snapchat. And I'm going to skip a little bit because the really juicy part starts down here. The Maynard's complaint alleges that around 10:15 p.m. one evening, McGee was driving with three passengers in her family's car. McGee began driving at an excessive rate of speed, attempting to reach 100 miles per hour so that she could capture that speed on a photograph using Snapchat's speed filter. A passenger checked the speed filter on her own phone, and it registered a speed in excess of 100 miles per hour. Meanwhile, unbeknownst to McGee, Wentworth Maynard had entered the same highway some distance ahead of McGee. Due to her distraction and unsafe speed, McGee drove into the back of Maynard's vehicle, injuring everyone involved. The Maynards sued McGee and Snapchat, seeking damages for negligence and loss of consortium, which is loss of your relations with your wife or spouse, and maybe family, depending upon how the law is written, as well as litigation expenses and punitive damages. The Maynards allege that McGee drove negligently and that Snapchat negligently designed the speed filter, encouraging users to endanger themselves and others on the roadway. Snapchat moved to dismiss the complaint or for a judgment on the pleadings, which is when there's enough information just on the initial pleadings, the complaint and the answer to the complaint, to have the court say, you know, here's a judgment. So this is not a motion to dismiss. This is a motion for a judgment, a little bit different, an actual factual final judgment. The trial court granted the motion for judgment. The trial court ruled that Snapchat had no duty to alter or design its mobile application to prevent McGee from driving recklessly or negligently. We granted the Maynard's application for an interlocutory or in the middle of litigation appeal, and this appeal followed. The Maynards argue, this is the victim, the Maynards argue that Snapchat violated its duty to use reasonable care in designing the speed filter product. And that's true that there is a duty of reasonable care. The court's going to disagree. Based on the facts of this case, the allegedly negligent design claim does not fall within Snapchat's duty of care to the plaintiffs. Quote, in order to have a viable negligence claim, so for law school students, negligence is presence of a duty, breach of that duty, injury caused by that breach. So four parts, duty, breach, injury, and cause. A plaintiff must satisfy the elements of the tort, namely the existence of a duty on the part of the defendant, a breach of that duty, causation of the alleged injury, and damages resulting from the alleged breach of that duty. Specifically, the legal duty is the obligation to conform to a standard of conduct under the law for the protection of others against reasonable risks of harm. But the innocence of the plaintiff is immaterial to the existence of the legal duty on part of the defendant, in that the plaintiff will not be entitled to recover unless the defendant did something that it should not have done, i.e. an action, or failed to do something it should have done, i.e. an omission, pursuant to the duty owed to the plaintiff under the law. And such a duty can arise either from a valid legislative enactment, that is, by statute, or be imposed by a common law principle recognized in the case law. Nevertheless, as the Supreme Court of Georgia has recently held, there is no general legal duty to all the world not to subject others to an unreasonable risk of harm. The Maynards argue that they have sufficiently alleged a duty on the part of Snapchat to design the product differently to avoid the circumstances that caused Maynard's injuries. The dissent agrees, relying on the risk-utility balancing test identified in Banks v. E.C. Adams, which it correctly identifies as the test for negligence in a design defect case such as this one. In that test, a trier of fact, so jury in a jury trial or judge in a bench trial, would evaluate design defectiveness under a test, balancing the risks inherent in a product design against the utility of the product so designed. But the applicability of that test does not obviate the requirement to identify a legal duty, which presents a legal question for the court. Here, the complaint alleges that the injury was caused by McGee's conduct of misusing the speed filter while driving at an excessive rate of speed. Thus, any liability on the part of Snapchat is predicated on McGee's conduct. Under Georgia law, there is no general legal duty to all the world not to subject others to an unreasonable risk of harm. And, quote, as a general rule, there is no duty to control the conduct of third persons to prevent them from causing physical harm to others. The two exceptions to this rule are when a special relationship exists between the actor and another, imposing a duty on the actor to control such person's conduct for the benefit of third persons, or a special relationship exists between the actor and another, giving such person a right to protection. No such special relationship is alleged here. Put simply, Georgia law does not impose a general duty to prevent people from committing torts while misusing a manufacturer's product. Although manufacturers have a duty to exercise reasonable care in manufacturing their products so as to make products that are reasonably safe for intended or foreseeable uses, this duty does not extend to the intentional, not accidental, misuse of the product in a tortious way by a third party. The Maynards allege that Snapchat's design contains an inherent incentive to engage in risky behavior, but they only point to the attractiveness of the product itself, not to any specific reward system or status ranking predicated on misusing it while driving or generating higher speeds. I have a point to make. According to the Maynards' own logic, if your car has a speedometer, then that must be an incentive for you to drive fast. Because there wasn't anything in the Snapchat app that said, you should go faster, get the highest speed possible. There wasn't anything encouraging someone to use the speed filter to achieve the highest score. That was social pressure or immaturity on the part of McGee wanting to get the highest score for themselves and for showing off. So the fact that a person wants to show off and does something stupid doesn't mean that the manufacturer of a speedometer or a GPS or even Snapchat's speed filter, that doesn't mean that Snapchat or the car manufacturer or the GPS manufacturer encouraged the misuse of the product, is what the court is saying here. Further, as pointed out by the trial court, the speed function is use neutral. It is equally functional when used when flying an airplane, while riding as a passenger stuck in a traffic jam, or when misused in a dangerous way. It is up to the user to avoid dangerously misusing the application. This is because virtually any article is capable of causing an injury when put to particular uses or misuses. And imposing a duty on Snapchat to control or avoid McGee's allegedly tortious conduct extends the imposition of a legal duty beyond that which the law should recognize. In fixing the bounds of duty, not only logic and science, but public policy play an important role. So just because it was easy for the kid, I'm assuming they were young people, just because it was easy for McGee to misuse the product doesn't mean that Snapchat was responsible for it. Ultimately, McGee decided to misuse the product in order to obtain a high speed and then get a picture or video of their high speed. Instead of extending such a broad duty to manufacturers, Georgia has focused its public policy in this area on the conduct of drivers. For example, in an effort to stem a recent increase in roadway deaths and rising automobile insurance premiums, the Georgia General Assembly, after forming a committee to study the issue of distracted driving, passed the 2018 hands-free law that focuses on drivers' conduct and prohibits them from even physically holding or supporting a smartphone while driving. Despite the inherent appeal and distracting nature of smartphone applications, Georgia thus far has not created a duty on the part of manufacturers to control third parties' use of mobile phone applications while driving. Let me extend this for you. If public policy wanted to extend a duty to the manufacturers, then the legislature could impose that duty by requiring car manufacturers, for example, to put maximum speed limits in their car. The car could detect what road it's on and could limit the car to the speed limit. And then if the car manufacturer somehow allowed this the car to go past the speed limit, then the car manufacturer maybe could be held responsible. But that's, again, not what's happening here. The legislature puts it on the user to use the product correctly, not by putting a limit on the manufacturer to control how the user uses the item. In other jurisdictions, courts have held that cell phone manufacturers do not have a duty to prevent the misuse of their applications, even in at least one case where the manufacturer understood the risk of misuse. In California, for example, the Court of Appeals addressed a suit against Apple based on a negligent driver's use of Apple's FaceTime video communication app. Apple had applied for a patent for lockout technology, which would prevent the use of the application while driving, noting in its patent application the increasing problem of driving while distracted by a cell phone. The court ultimately held that Apple did not have a duty to control its users' conduct while driving, stating that even if it were foreseeable that cell phone use by drivers could result in accidents, foreseeability is not synonymous with duty, nor is it a substitute. Likewise, with respect to enticement to engage in dangerous conduct, in a Texas case involving a crash during a mechanic's test drive of a V8-powered Cadillac Eldorado, the plaintiff, who was hit and killed in his front yard by the out-of-control vehicle, asserted negligence on the part of GM for designing a vehicle so capable of easily exceeding safe speeds. In other words, do you want to have your car's speed limited because some people will drive improperly? The plaintiff alleged that GM's design was negligent and pointed to GM's marketing material that, with a wink and a nod, implicitly invited drivers to test the full potential of vehicle's performance capability. Quote, here's the marketing. You feel the surge of its 32-valve, 295 horsepower V8. As you reach 60 miles an hour in 7.5 seconds, the road sensing suspension is actually reading every inch of the road. The feedback from the speed sensitive steering grows progressively firmer as you quickly pass 100 miles an hour. Of course, you wouldn't really do this because you're not a professionally trained driver on a closed track. But if you were, the full-range traction control assures maximum grip as you approach 150 miles per hour. The trial court granted summary judgment to GM, and the Texas Court of Appeals affirmed on the ground that there is no legal duty to control the actions of third parties absent some special relationship. And GM has not created a special relationship by running the ad campaign. Yeah, an ad campaign that specifically discloses that you should only be doing this if you are professionally trained and on a closed track. In other words, you can take your car to the Nürburgring and test its traction and its speed and its acceleration and its handling at the speeds allowed by that track. What you can't do is do it on the open road in public, putting others in danger. Although the facts of this case are tragic and compelling, they should not create a duty where the law has not already recognized one. If we were to default to the risk-utility balancing test in this case without identifying a legal duty, it would eliminate the plaintiff's burden to assert the elements of a cognizable tort claim. In other words, it would bypass the law. Accordingly, we conclude that the trial court did not err by granting Snapchat's motion to dismiss, which I believe is the correct finding here. But there is one judge who dissents, and maybe we should read Judge McFadden, the chief judge's dissent. I respectfully dissent, Chief Judge McFadden says. At this time, it cannot be said that the allegations of the complaint disclose with certainty that the Maynards would not be entitled to relief under any state of provable facts asserted in support, so I would reverse. The novelty of the technology and the circumstances at issue should not distract us. There is nothing novel about the legal questions before us. The Maynards' allegations fall squarely within the requirements for stating a claim for defective design implicating risk-utility analysis. To establish such a claim, a plaintiff must demonstrate that the defendant is the manufacturer of a product that had a design defect at the time it was sold that proximately caused the plaintiff's injury. I don't know, do you consider having a speedometer a design defect? I don't know how that is a design defect, but okay, good job, judge. See generally Banks Supra setting forth the appropriate test for design defect claims based on theories of negligence as well as strict liability. Whether a particular design is defective is determined by balancing the risks inherent in the product design against the utility of the product so designed. The Maynards alleged that, one, Snapchat created the speed filter. Two, Snapchat's design choices rendered the speed filter unreasonably dangerous by encouraging its users to drive at excessive speeds. I mean, I didn't see the pleadings below, but I have not seen any evidence in the majority's opinion saying that Snapchat promoted the speed filter. Drive as fast as you can. Get to the top speed. Submit your high score. Would be marketing material that I think would allow the judge to say that it was encouraged and therefore negligently designed and a duty was owed, etc. Wentworth Maynard was injured in the collision as a result of Crystal McGee's use of the speed filter, a use that was reasonably foreseeable. I don't know, do we always have to design to the lowest common denominator? Do we have to design toasters to turn off as quickly as possible if somebody drops them in the bathtub? I mean, do we really expect people to be that dumb in all cases? Is that reasonably foreseeable? I don't know. I don't think it is my job to make sure that you can't use a knife to cut yourself. What's a knife meant to do? A knife is meant to cut. So do I have to design a knife to make sure that stupid people can't cut themselves, or clumsy people can't cut themselves, or homicidal people can't kill someone? I don't see how that's a thing. I think it is reasonable to design a knife to be a knife and make sure that you don't design a knife that hit in a hidden way can't, you know, you go to cut something and the knife flips to the side and stabs you when you were trying to cut straight in front of you. I mean, that's negligent design. Not, I designed a knife to be a knife, and because somebody negligently cut themselves or someone else, that means my knife was negligently designed. I think that's what's going on here. If you have a speedometer in a car, that's like saying that because the car and the speedometer can show 150 miles an hour, that means that people should reasonably, we should reasonably believe or reasonably foresee that people will drive the car 150 miles an hour. That's a level of nanny state that I'm not really ready to legally impose duties on people about. These allegations sufficiently gave Snapchat fair notice of the claim and a general indication of the type of litigation which should survive a motion to dismiss. So it sounds like the chief judge is dissenting, saying that at least they should have had a trial on this and allowed the Maynard plaintiff to try their case, to prove their case. We are unable to say with certainty that the Maynards would not be entitled to relief under any state of facts which could be proved in support of their general allegations. So the allegations of the complaint do not disclose with certainty that the Maynards would not be entitled to relief under any state of provable facts because Snapchat owed no duty to the Maynards. Rather, they set out a substantively conventional design defect claim. Quote, "The heart of a design defect case is the reasonableness of selecting from among alternative product designs and adopting the safest feasible one. Consequently, the appropriate analysis does not depend on the use of the product, as that may be narrowly or broadly defined, but rather includes the consideration of whether the defendant failed to adopt a reasonable alternative design which would have reduced the foreseeable risks of harm presented by the product." Again, I disagree. Having a speedometer does not make it reasonably foreseeable that someone will be encouraged to misuse the speedometer in a dangerous way. Having a speedometer does not make you drive faster. It only reports the speed. So having a speedometer does not in any way, just all by itself, without more, without marketing saying, go fast, go as fast as you can, I don't think that presents such a duty. And I think you can dismiss that on a motion to dismiss. Snapchat's duty is to exercise reasonable care in designing its products so as to make products that are reasonably safe for intended or foreseeable uses. Since the appropriate analysis does not depend on the use of the product, but instead includes consideration of whether the defendant failed to adopt a reasonable alternative design which would have reduced the foreseeable risks of harm, the Maynard sufficiently alleged such a duty. The Maynard's allegations that Snapchat failed to adopt a reasonable design leading to a foreseeable use or misuse of the speed filter thus foreseeably caused their injuries and is sufficient to state a claim. Now, on a motion to dismiss, the defendant is making the motion to dismiss. The plaintiff's case is supposed to be read in a light most favorable to the plaintiff. So if the plaintiff makes out the basics of their case in a factual way, the facts should be seen in the light most favorable to the plaintiff. So I can see where the judge is going with this. He's just saying that we at least met the motion to dismiss standard and the plaintiff should have a trial. He or she is not saying that the plaintiff wins. The dissent is not saying the plaintiff wins. The dissent is saying that the plaintiff has at least made a basic case that should go forward to discovery, then either summary judgment or a trial. The majority holds that the duty to adopt a reasonable design does not extend to the intentional, not accidental, misuse of the product in a tortious way by a third party. In so holding, the majority creates new law. There is no support for it in the cases cited. The majority cites, for comparison, Jones. In Jones, our Supreme Court answered a certified question arising out of a case in which plaintiff had tripped over an exercise machine and contended that its design had aggravated her injuries. In a products liability case comes the holding, for defective design, the focus is not on the use of the product. Contrary to the majority's new rule, the existing rule is that reasonably foreseeable product use or misuse is a factor in considering whether a manufacturer may be liable for a defective product, which was a proximate cause of harm resulting from the failure to adopt a reasonable alternative design. Okay, bypassing the motion to dismiss standard, what's the reasonable alternative design? Do they have to have a statement in the alternative? Instead of not having something saying, go as fast as you can, do they have to have something that says, you shouldn't go as fast as you can? Or can they just have a speedometer? Does there have to be a disclaimer on your car's dashboard saying, you shouldn't drive just fast as you can just because you have a speedometer? I have a feeling, you know, following that logic is going to lead to these like instruction books. Whenever you get a product, you get like, you know, I have a little laser pointer measurement device here, and it came with a whole series of like instructions, like don't point this at your eye, don't point this at your cat's eye, don't point this at helicopters, and don't point this at airplanes. It's like, yeah, kind of duh at some point. Maybe you have the disclaimer, you know, don't point this at things that will get hurt by it. I kind of understand that to a point, but then some of these safety manuals get to be dozens of pages thick trying to tell you not to misuse, in my previous example, not to cut people with knives. Do we really need to have a book coming with every knife that says, this thing is sharp, you could cut somebody with it. Don't do that. At some point, it becomes ridiculous. And I don't think Snapchat had any duty to make sure that no one could use their speed filter while driving. I just don't get where our technology has not reached the point where it is so cheap to pay for map licenses that have accurate speed limits and then prevent people from using apps to show speeds on roads. This happens with DJI drones, for example. DJI tries to implement the FAA's flight restrictions in such a way so that consumers can't fly DJI drones in areas where they're not allowed to fly drones, so in areas with flight restrictions. Well, sometimes professionals have clearance to fly those drones. So what happens to a professional using a drone as intended, a drone they paid for, in a flight-restricted area where they have obtained clearance from the FAA or the local tower or whatever the law says they have to do? So now you're creating kind of a blanket nanny state where DJI is saying you can't use our drones in flight-restricted areas and then provides no further way to overcome that exception or that restriction when you do have approval from the right governing body. So this is going to reach a point where if we follow this dissenting judge's logic out, that you won't be able to use a speedometer because you could potentially use a speedometer incorrectly. That's where this is going, and that's why I don't agree with the dissent here. And application of the majority's new rule drawing a crucial distinction between negligent and intentional misuses is problematic, at least in this case. The proper characterization of Crystal McGee's overall conduct is not self-evident. Her misuse of the app was intentional, but the immediate proximate cause of the collision was her negligent driving. In other words, he or she, the judge, is saying that Crystal McGee intended to speed, not intended to hit the plaintiff. I forgot his name already. The problem with that is that we often do extend proximate cause to the foreseeable consequences of your misuse. So if she intentionally misused the speedometer on the speed filter and then caused an injury, then it's not necessarily that she intended to cause the injury, but she intended the act that caused the injury, and it was reasonably foreseeable that the injury could occur, that driving too fast and driving while looking at your phone can cause an injury. So we sometimes treat that like an intentional tort anyway. I doubt that they're going to get treble damages because of the intentionalness of the misuse of the Snapchat filter, but that would be on the table. There would be a legal argument that the reasonably foreseeable consequences of the intentional misuse of the app is Crystal McGee's problem. The majority invokes public policy in support of its new rule, but the policy of Georgia is derived from its statutes and judicial decisions. The public policy of this state is created by our Constitution, our statutes, and our decisions. And our Supreme Court has articulated that the public policy of Georgia, by explicitly delineating a manufacturer's duty in the context of products liability, a duty that encompasses the foreseeable misuse of the product. The majority cites no case from our Supreme Court or this court that relieves manufacturers of that duty simply because a plaintiff's injuries resulted from a third party's intentional misuse of the product. At this time, it cannot be said that the allegations of the complaint disclose with certainty that the Maynards would not be entitled to relief under any state of parole facts asserted in support of their complaint, so the trial court erred in granting Snapchat's motion, and I would reverse. I probably would not reverse. I think it is self-evident that Snapchat did not have any duty to foresee the misuse in this way. They did not encourage the misuse, and therefore I don't think they're in any way that could be held liable. But that's just my opinion. The just over the other side of the line, not real far over the other side of the line, is the Chief Justice trying to say that we're at a motion to dismiss stage, we're at the pleading stage, and that the plaintiff should at least have the chance to prove their case. And if they can't prove their case, then they still lose. But we shouldn't be dismissing the case in the Chief Justice's dissent prematurely, because the plaintiff might still be able to uncover some facts or discovery or make some argument that convinces a jury or a judge in a bench trial that Snapchat did know, in fact, that its speed filter would be misused, or that it did have some kind of marketing that said, you know, use the speed filter to get the highest possible speed and post it and get the high score and be the envy of your friends for going so fast. We've seen countless videos on the internet of people speeding in their cars on video to try and be cool and then crashing. That should be on the people who are doing that, not on a phone company for making a phone that records video. Oh, well, you made a video camera. You should have known that people would use the camera to film themselves doing dangerous things, and doing dangerous things could injure someone, especially someone else. So the phone manufacturer or the camera manufacturer should have known better and should have included a disclaimer in their 500-page book of disclaimers that says, don't use this camera to film yourself doing something dangerous. Don't use this camera to film something that could hurt somebody else. Don't use this camera to speed on the highway. Don't use this camera to speed off the highway. Don't use this camera. Could you imagine? I mean, we're already kind of headed there with some of these things, but I really like my knife example. Do we really need to include a 500-page book of disclaimers about how not to use a knife whenever you buy a knife? Or is it pretty well understood that knives are sharp, don't stab people with them, don't use it in a negligent way? I don't know. That's a argument that we can have. Let's have the argument in the comments. Let me know what you think below. And that's our show. Thanks for joining me. I'm Leonard French, your favorite copyright attorney, and this is Lawful Masses, your favorite legal news and education program here on YouTube, also on Floatplane and on Twitch. Thank you to our supporters on patreon.com/LJFrench and sponsus.com/law, as well as those who are YouTube members and Twitch subs and Floatplane members. Really appreciate you all. In the month of November, at the $50 level, thank you to Joe Tyson, Wes Delge, Citizen of the Sovereign, John Steele, Gavin Barnard, Evie, Kyle Mudrock, Spirit Bear, Andy, Benjamin Hightoff, Goliath Cleric, Ugly Grill, Shiloh T, Rudolph Bescherer Jr., Oscar the Prophet, Jay Dixon, Hot Grills in Your Area, Brandon Abel, Torpedon, Cassandra Curran, Mayor of Titty City, Shadow Tycho, RDH Dragon, Earthbound Star, and No Copyright Violation Intended. And thank you to the $5 plus supporters. You're scrolling on the LED panel behind me and in the description of the videos. I love you all. I will see you in the videos that drop. Bye.